Good morning and welcome. Okay, first session of the day, first session of the conference. The session today and this morning is Overview of Business Intelligence in Office and SharePoint 2013. My name is Peter Myers. I'm your presenter. Having come all the way from Australia, accent's a little bit American. I have spent the past few years working in California and close to Microsoft, and I occasionally cross the Tasman. Now that I'm based home in Melbourne, I end up in Tasmania with regularity, here presenting and training in business intelligence. This session then is to introduce and to potentially excite you with the potential of what you can achieve for business intelligence with Office 2013 and SharePoint. We're going to start by defining what is self-service business intelligence, and then I'll introduce Microsoft's BI strategy and vision, and then we'll walk through the business intelligence capabilities delivered in Office, primarily with Excel, but there's also a Visio story to be told today. And then we'll explore the collaboration side with SharePoint and what we can then do with our solutions up there in the SharePoint server. So the outline will be an intro to SSBI. We'll cover off on Office 2013, then move into SharePoint 2013. Who remembers this guy? When was the last time we saw Clippy? Office 97? No. Office XP? No. Office 2003, wasn't that XP? I think it was Office 2002. Was there such a release? From memory, it was Office XP where he got the cut. And I think that was in 2003. So how about this? I miss Clippy in the sense that, you know, I guess in a certain bizarre sense, he was there to help you. Office was becoming complex. There were a lot of capabilities and features that were buried in levels of menus that people didn't know existed. So I think the concept here was that Clippy was there to bring your attention to capabilities that perhaps you weren't aware of. This session is to bring to your attention capabilities that perhaps you're not aware of, with a focus on business intelligence. Let's start with the topic then of self-service BI. This is a growing area of interest for a business, especially if you're an IT person that is tired of the constant requests coming from the business. We've got a meeting tomorrow morning at 10 o'clock. The manager needs to know what per capita sales were. Can you stop everything you're doing and help us? Or could you put that in the data warehouse and then we'll help ourselves? You'll find that the reality is that IT are way too busy to drop for per request that you have. The idea is that the IT business could empower back to the users to say, well, let's make data available to you, let's make the correct and appropriate tools and permissions to connect to corporate data available. Yes, we'll give you some training as well, and then that should empower you to go ahead and create your own solution that will address the need for tomorrow morning's meeting. All right, so self-service business intelligence is about that empowerment. There's a mutual benefit to be achieved by working together on this. Now, some IT groups are somewhat nervous about enabling and supporting self-service BI because it may move in an undesirable direction. For example, multiple versions of the truth start to proliferate, and we end up with inconsistent calculations, inconsistent data out there, and yes, there is a possibility of this. So we see a very tight coupling between IT and the business in ensuring that governance is observed, that there are certain controls and monitoring in place to ensure that the self-service BI is managed appropriately. All right, so that introduces the topic then of managed BI. It's one thing to push back to the business, it's one thing to manage it also and ensure that governance is being applied. We'll see that Office and SharePoint do have a role in delivering self-service BI, and there are capabilities built into SharePoint, the sharing and collaboration platform, to support various governance requirements. Microsoft's strategy and vision has not changed in the past 12 years that I've been talking about Microsoft BI, and it continues to be about empowering individuals to discover insights within their data. SQL Server as a data platform supports end-to-end BI. Office, with its productivity tools and with SharePoint, is about delivering self-service BI to the masses. The investments that are being made from Microsoft for the end users, a complete and powerful self-service BI in Excel. With every release of Excel, I notice there are new capabilities and features designed to dig deeper and discover more insights from data, and to do this without the assistance of IT. For the IT professional, enterprise-grade governance and scale with SharePoint, not just as content management, but through workflows, logging of usage and the monitoring of that. So Office 2013 is a suite of productivity applications. These applications play a major role in empowering those individuals in the business to produce self-service solutions. Notably, Excel is king here with its capabilities beyond the core spreadsheeting capabilities to support data discovery and reporting. Visio has a minor role to play, and I look forward to demonstrating you a scenario with it this morning. So Excel, over the past decade, this core spreadsheeting capabilities have incrementally been increased with reporting and analytic capabilities. It's of interest to note that there are an estimated 1 billion installations of Office in the world today, and of that, an estimated 600 million Excel users. And I think the requirement is that they use it at least once a month to be determined that they're an Excel user. So what better tool to choose as a BI client than Excel? It's widely installed, it's widely understood, people know how to use it, they just need some incremental information on how to connect to data and how to manipulate and report on that data inside Excel. So there are various add-ins that move beyond the basic features that are delivered with Excel. Power Pivot is an add-in that supports rich data modeling inside the Excel workbook itself. Power Query is in preview, and this is the ability to source and transform and prepare data for usage within Excel, perhaps loading it directly into the data model. Power Map is a three-dimensional geospatial representation of your analytic data, and the ability to produce tours in the form of movies that then can be used to tell a story about your data geographically. And then finally, there are data mining add-ins. We've had these since the 2007 release of Excel. These provide two capabilities, to work with tabular data in Excel and perform basic data mining functions. The other is to produce fully-fledged data mining solutions within the Excel workbook itself. So it just becomes an environment upon which you can connect to a server, define data mining models, process them, query them, and so on. So there's a huge story to tell here. Power Query, Flash Fill, the data model, Power Pivot, apps for Office support the ability to access, cleanse, and mash up data together. I have a demo coming on this in just a moment. For the visualization and exploration, you have the new Quick Analysis feature, you have Quick Explore, you have Power View, introduced in Excel 2013, the ability for interactive, highly impressive reports within the workbook itself based on a tabular or, in fact, an analysis services data model, which could be the workbook data model. There's also Power Map that I've just described with the three-dimensional geospatial analysis. Finally, when it comes to sharing this, it's not an appropriate way to just take your Excel workbook. It may consist of data, logic, and reports. Don't send that to everybody. There is this temptation to attach it to an email, distribute that. The supported way that Microsoft suggests is that you publish it to SharePoint as a content management system. There you can secure it, and then via the URL, which you can send to everybody, here's the report, here's the data that you need to work from. Okay, Power Pivot is perhaps the most impressive business intelligence capability built into Excel. Essentially, it provides data modeling capabilities within Excel. It uses the analysis services X Velocity in-memory analytics engine. So essentially, what gets installed with Excel 2013, and I'm talking Professional Plus Edition, or Office 365, what gets installed is this engine on the client. Extremely powerful because it allows you to import potential masses of data. You know, hundreds of millions of rows of data can be imported. They are encoded, compressed, and stored in a very efficient form that is compact and highly efficient to be queried within the workbook itself using familiar reporting capabilities like pivot tables, charts, and so on. So, huge story to be told about Power Pivot. In fact, my test as a trainer or as a consultant, that when I go into a customer and I see the potential for this or to identify potential, it would be, well, does anyone here work with the VLOOKUP function? And in this audience this morning, does anyone work with the VLOOKUP function? Okay, so perhaps about 20% of you. Does anyone not know what the VLOOKUP function is? No shame if you don't. Okay, so the VLOOKUP function is about basically data integration. Look up a value in a related range. It's a way of integrating two data sets together. If you're doing this consistently within a workbook, I would suggest a more efficient way is to load the data as tables into PowerPivot and to establish a relationship. And once you've done so, you can use calculations to navigate those relationships far more efficiently than you could by using VLOOKUP functions. There's another limitation that I think is interesting to be aware of in Excel, especially these days when we're working with much larger volumes of data than in the past. What is the maximum number of rows that we can store in a worksheet?
1 million.
All right, to that man there, I will give you a prize. 1,048,576, or 2 to the power of 20 is another way of perhaps more concisely expressing that. They are the maximum rows per worksheet in a workbook. If you have more rows of data than that, you're going to struggle. You might have to partition it. You might have to work with a smaller time period to start analyzing and reporting from that data. But I'll share with you that PowerPivot does not have such a limitation. It is, in fact, limited by the size of the compressed data. And I've seen examples of over 100 million rows of data stored inside a single Excel workbook. All right, so instead of loading the data direct into worksheets, we can load it into PowerPivot, and then we can report from it. Let's see this by demonstration. I think a classic example of demonstrating PowerPivot is to talk about a real-world scenario. And the real-world scenario is often this, that we've got this meeting tomorrow morning, my manager is interested to know about profit, and yet when we go to our data warehouse or our internal systems, there's no profit calculations for us. I've got a sales system, it tells me what products were sold when and to who and where, but nothing about cost or profit. So inside this Excel workbook, and to speed up this demonstration, what I'll share with you is I've used PowerPivot to go ahead and extract data from a corporate system. It's resulted in four tables, date, state, sales, and product. Note the absence of anything to do with cost or profit. All right, and this would enable me then to partially produce a solution here in Excel. I could perform some sales analysis by inserting a pivot table. And here in the pivot table, I could say, well, I'm looking at sales. I would like to know by products what I have. And I'd also like to filter this by year. And I'm interested in the year that is 2010. And then I can introduce slices as well to provide interactive filtering. So in my state table, I have a level called region. Go ahead and add that level as a slicer, and then I can go ahead and drill down and filter by region. And that's a basic PowerPivot example. It's not so compelling yet. My manager's over my shoulder saying, yeah, but where's the profit? I need to report on this in tomorrow morning's meeting. Okay. Well, the fact is, for the 20 products that we have at this company called Tailspin Toys, it sells and manufactures model aeroplanes and helicopters, is that data is available inside an Excel workbook here. For each of the 20 products, I've got a stock keeping unit and I've got the product cost associated with it. So what I'm going to do is enrich the PowerPivot model by incorporating data from that Excel workbook. Where is that workbook? There it is. Yes, the first row includes column headers. Click Next. I can preview the data here before I load it. And as an optimization, I would actually tell it not to import the product column. I already have the name from the source system. I just need the stock keeping unit to establish a relationship. And this is the cost information I need for each product. So when I click Finish, it imports the data from the workbook. And that results in a new table being added into the data model. And no VLOOKUP function required, just a drag and drop. Stock keeping unit relates to stock keeping unit. I can now come across to the sales table and then I can introduce a new what we call calculated column using DAX, an expression language defined for enriching the data model. Bring in the related column from the product cost table that is the product cost, and then multiply it by the quantity column. And that will give me the cost of goods sold for each sales transaction that's recorded in this table. Rename the column. This becomes COGS. Format this as currency. Now, when we analyze, what we're interested in is the aggregation of cost. And ignore this error, it's just catching up. I'm too fast for it in the demo. So now that I have renamed the column, I can go ahead and use the auto sum to create an aggregation of the values in this column. Give me the sum of COGS. Calling it sum of COGS is not as elegant as I'd like it to be. We can just call it cost. And now I can hide this column. What that means is anyone that connects to this data model, they will find in my sales table a calculation which is cost. They're going to find another calculation which is profit, which is the sales with cost subtracted from it. And I'll have that formatted as a currency. And I can also introduce in profitability, which I'll make equal to sales. No, I won't. I'll make it equal to profit. Now, the reason that I'm doing this is that I'm going to convert this calculation into a key performance indicator. So basically, the profit divided by sales gives me a measure of profitability. And then I can define that, well, if we only meet 5% or less profitability, that's off track. If it's between 5 and 15%, it's slightly off track. Otherwise, 15% or above is going to be considered to be a good and healthy profitability to maintain. And this is the indicator that should be used to express the status of this KPI. So now switching back to the diagram view, we can see that we've added in product cost. I can now hide this table. Its role was simply to introduce cost so that it could surface through this column and then through this calculation. I've now extended the sales table to include cost, profit, and profitability. And so now I can address my manager's needs by coming into here and saying, well, let's enrich this report with the value and status of the profit. Okay, so we can observe here that the glider is slightly off track. That's because one of the products in that category is well off track. Okay, and there's a classic example, in my opinion, of where Power Pivot has been designed to fit. Corporate systems are not directly addressing all needs that we have. We can start with corporate data, and then we can integrate it with local, ad hoc, or external data, and then enrich it with calculations. That's the example of completing a Power Pivot workbook. The next Excel topic to explore, then, is Power Query. Formerly known as Data Explorer, Power Query is in preview, and it's publicly available for you to download and to experiment with today. It's supported in both Excel 2010 Service Pack 1 or Excel 2013. It allows you to connect to a wide variety of data sources. And in doing so, you can introduce the data into Excel. And before it lands in Excel, you can procedurally transform and prepare the data. Okay, so I'm not exactly happy with what the source has. Let me go ahead and remove columns, rename them, filter. And it can work from the simple to extremely sophisticated roles when it comes to transforming and preparing that data. So let's take a look at this in example. My manager's never happy. Fine, we now have profitability in the data model. The next requirement he has is per capita sales. How effective have our marketing campaigns been at a regional level? Okay, well, that's a great and valid question. And again, we go to the data warehouse to discover that there is nothing there that's going to directly help. We'll have to work this out for ourselves. So a scrounge around the internet, and because this is a US company, I've come across this website here, which shows the census population broken down by state. The information is not exactly in the format I want. It has states with population, but you'll note it also has a rank column. That's of no interest to me here in this analysis. It also has a summary here for the United States. And yet I'm interested at state level. So what I'm going to do is take this URL, switch back to Excel, and on the Power Query tab, that tab is there because I've installed the add-in, you'll see that you have the ability to introduce data from the web, from a variety of text formats, a rich variety of databases, and take a look here from other sources, SharePoint lists, OData feeds, Azure Marketplace, Hadoop, HD Insight, Active Directory, even Facebook data could be loaded in. For this demonstration, it's coming from the web, and I paste in that URL. And then it comes back and says, okay, we're going to produce a query on top of this. Instead of calling it query one, I'm going to call it state population. There is an HTML table that I select here, and sure enough, there's the tabular list of states and numbers and ranks. Now, when I turn on the formula bar, what you'll see is there's actually a command to go ahead and retrieve that set of data. And then what I'm going to do is, first of all, right-click rank and remove it. And what you'll notice over here on the right-hand side is that I've just introduced a step, and that step is this command here. I'm going to rename this column, and it will become census population. I'm not interested in the United States, so I can go ahead and filter it out. And ultimately, I've produced a series of four steps here that transform the data from the web into the desired state. When I click done, it introduces a new sheet into the workbook and it adds a table that includes the result. Here in the query settings pane, I can click on load to data model and that table can be loaded directly into the Power Pivot model. And here it is, state population. So given that I've got state, I can relate these. And it's the same story now. This time the data's been sourced from the web and it is refreshable through the workbook. I can now come into the population table and I can create a calculation here that will aggregate the census population to produce a new calculation called simply population. I can then switch across to the sales table and now I can create a new calculation that is sales per capita equals sales divided by population. Format that as a currency. And there's the new calculation, and now I can go ahead and hide this table so that users don't see that it exists, but they can benefit from this calculation here. Switching back to Excel then, I might choose to hide this sheet. And my sales analysis report, I can now come in and say, well, tell me what sales per capita were for that region and for those products for that time period. There's an example of how we could use Power Query to source and prepare data and load it directly into the data model, although that's not a requirement. Once the data's in Excel, that could be the beginning of an entirely different story. Are there any questions at this stage? All right, let's move on. The visualization of the data that you have in Excel. In particular, if you have a data model, like the Power Pivot model that I've just developed, the way that you can effectively visualize the data within the same workbook is done with pivot tables or pivot charts. The cube functions, and I'm interested to know here, has anyone worked with the cube functions in Excel before? Four people, okay. Great news for you at this event. I have a second session today immediately after lunch. 60 minutes is not quite enough, but I'll make the best of that time to go through the seven cube functions that are delivered with Excel and have been delivered since the 2007 release. There's some really amazing and creative things you can do cell by cell to extract members, properties, values from a data model and lay out a dashboard-style report, for example, inside Excel. This was to be part of this presentation, but it's been sacrificed in recognition that we've got an entire session dedicated to it this afternoon. Power View is another option when it comes to presenting from your data model, and I will demonstrate it. Apps for Office, I'll reserve for this afternoon as well. What's new in Office 2013 is the ability to add these little apps that are written using HTML, JavaScript, and other web technologies. This is the ability for you to reach out to a marketplace, potentially source free or subscribe to paying apps, and to extend Excel into new creative ways. All right, so there's some free ones like gauges that are expressive for KPIs. Bing Maps is free. You've also got cute ones like Bubbles, which I think I'll demonstrate this afternoon. So apps for office also get dropped out of this morning's session, but we'll show you these this afternoon. Power Map is the other capability, another add-in, also in preview at the moment for 3D spatial analysis of your data. So let's start with PowerView. I won't go through the basic pivot table, I've demonstrated that one already. PowerView was first available as part of Reporting Services 2012, integrated with SharePoint, and it's still available that way via the web browser. It's now available with Excel 2013. The only requirements are that you have Professional Plus or the equivalent edition with Office 365, and that you have internet connectivity, and that you have Silverlight. And by the way, the internet connectivity is for mapping only. If you don't want to work with mapping, you don't even need the internet. It's all designed around the principle of producing very sexy interactive reports with as few clicks as possible. And it will require that you have a data model to report from. Now, that could mean the PowerPivot data model that I've already developed is the perfect source. Or it could mean that you just select a range of data in Excel and create a PowerView report on it. Internally, Excel just loads that data into the data model, and the PowerView reporting takes place on that range of data. Okay, so it's very, very easy and straightforward to get started. Let's show you in demonstration what I can do with PowerView. So I'm going to go ahead and insert PowerView. Okay, so basically this is the blank canvas. What we see on the right-hand side is the PowerPivot data model. So this could be titled something like sales per capita. And then I like to come into the date table and I have a year column expressed as a field. It adds the distinct years as the first column in a new table. Now, when you have a single column table, you can go ahead and convert that to become a slicer. And now there's interactive filtering built into the view itself. Let's just increase the font to make that clearer. And anything that we now see on this sheet via my selection for the year 2010 is filtering by that year. Now, by clicking in a blank area of the canvas, I can commence the design of a new table. And the new table will consist of my state and that new calculated field, which is the sales per capita. And if I enlarge this, I can click once to sort this column ascending, click descending. And what we can learn from this is that in 2010, it was the state of Delaware that was achieving the best penetration at 85 cents per person within that state. Now, if you have internet connectivity, you can transform a table into a variety of different visualizations. The one here that I'll demonstrate, fingers crossed, we have internet connectivity in the room, is the map. The reason that I need the internet is that there's communication going on with the Bing Maps service. Two things it's doing. First of all, for each state, it should be geocoding to retrieve the latitude, longitude. And then the next thing it's doing is retrieving visually the maps themselves. And I'm not terribly optimistic this is going to work. In the best of cases, it usually does. It's just that the internet connectivity here is somewhat iffy this morning for me. Okay, so what I want you to do is use your imaginations for me. We would see a lovely map of the United States, and you're going to see a blue bubble on each one. The size of the bubble represents proportionally the sales per capita. So we'd expect to see that for the state of Delaware in the northeast, a larger bubble than would be for the state of Texas, which is probably lower on the list. Okay, and what would have been visually impressive, and I'll ask you to visualize again, is that it's completely interactive. I could zoom in, pan, I could hover over the bubbles. I could also categorize those bubbles by product category, and then we'd get little pie charts sitting on each of the states. And then on the left-hand side, I could filter by different years to then observe the change, or the effect of sales per capita that we have. So apologies that the internet isn't my friend this morning. I'm sorry? Is the map of New Zealand available? I think it just came in. I'm joking, yes. The entire world is available. Middle Earth is the one that I'm thinking is just coming in. Okay, what this means is for you to successfully represent your data geographically is that either, and the best approach and the fail-proof approach is you have latitude and longitude directly in your data. If you have two columns, lat long in decimal format, then you don't even have to bother Bing Maps to do the geocoding. It will retrieve the maps and it will place your locations at the coordinates. If you don't, you'll need text data that describes things like states, cities, and so on. So I know I've had some fun with this with New Zealand audiences before. Wellington, I think there's more than one Wellington in the world. I don't think you were the first, let's put it that way. So for example, what Bing Maps will do, if you just provide a single city name, it'll probably use the most populated or popular based on search for it. So therefore, you'll need to enrich your data model with additional data, like Wellington, New Zealand. Okay, but it will map right down to the individual address and even landmarks. So Sky City Hotel, for example, and the tower. All you would need is that as a text value in your model, and it would map it. Any other questions at this stage? Okay, so the question is, can we create anything beyond, can we express our data beyond points? No. In PowerView, it'll just use bubbles on top of points to convey that. Now, PowerMap is a different story, and PowerMap can use different visualizations, but it still uses points to determine. Next topic. Still under the category of visualizations, it's these apps for Office. As I described earlier, the ability now to place these HTML applets inside and to relate them to data ranges within the Excel workbook. Okay, here's an example of what the gauge would look like. These require internet connectivity, which I don't successfully have. So this is something I'm going to reserve for the cube functions demonstration immediately after lunch today. Cool thing about these is you can source free ones, you can source and pay for other ones, or if you're so inclined, you can develop your own libraries of them, use them internally, or even publish them, and there could be a revenue stream you could generate from an in-demand app. So no, I won't be able to do that demonstration. Power Map. Well, guess what? It also requires the internet. But intentionally, I'm not demonstrating this one. We have a session with Dandy Wayne on Thursday, that's tomorrow, which goes through the topic of Power BI. And so Power Map will be a focus of that presentation. So essentially, its requirements are that you have downloaded and installed the Power Map preview, and then you would need a data model upon which you would analyze the data, and then you could use three-dimensional interactive visualization techniques to bring that data to life. The idea of this product is a little different from the others, is that a PowerView tour is what you create, is a collection of scenes, like scenes in a movie, and you will stitch these together and you can produce this experience that tells a story through data, through three-dimensional geospatial representation, and annotations can be added on top. And there's even the cool feature of animating across time to see the data move on top of your map. It's something that you need to see, and unfortunately, it's been cut from this demo anyway, regardless of whether I had internet connectivity, because it's one of the focuses of tomorrow. Last topic then for Excel, moving beyond the visualizations, is to take a look at the data mining capabilities. And this is a favorite topic of mine, and I'm aware there's a data mining session also that you might be interested in on Friday morning. Here is data mining for the business user direct, and in fact, there are two add-ins. These are free, they've been available in Excel 2007, 2010, and 2013. Free to download, however, the data mining engine is on the server. It does require that analysis services in data mining mode is installed, and that the business user has the permission to connect to it. Now, the first add-in, which is the table analysis tools, will do data mining on Excel table data. All right. The cool thing about this add-in is there's no such wording of data mining used in any of the experience. data mining is the technology under the covers that just does some pretty cool stuff. So it's highly approachable to business analysts that are looking to do simple forecasts, looking for anomalies within data, looking to fill in missing values within the set that they have. They can use data mining under the covers to assist them. The second add-in is the client tool that provides pretty much end-to-end data mining capabilities that would typically be delivered via a development environment like Visual Studio. Then they've gone ahead and replicated a lot of the capability, including data preparation, inside Excel as another add-in. So that means the data mining person has the ability to work with Visual Studio or Excel. Let me go ahead and demonstrate this one for you, which is the table tools. In my Excel workbook, what I have is the ability to, is to forecast what the next 2 months of our demographic sales would be. So here's a good example of where I've called on the assistance of IT. They've said, well, look, you can do this through an add-in. This is how you do it. This is how you connect to the data mining server. And in order to get the data in the right format for you, we'll actually create a view, and that'll be your starting point. So on the data tab, I can come in here and source data from the SQL Server instance that IT told me about. Inside the Tailspin Toys database, they've created this view called 2010 Demographic Sales. So by introducing that view, it adds a table to the workbook, and here it is. 12 rows of data. The first column is the time index. So you can see they're in numeric format, first month of 2010. And then we have four or five columns representing the different demographics. So in essence, there are five time series here of the demographic sales for 2010. Now, when you have a table in focus, this is not in focus. This is in focus. You will see that the table tools pop up automatically. And the Analyze tab here is exposing to us the functionality of the table analysis tools. As I mentioned, the word data mining is not used in any of this, but we can use capabilities like forecast. That'll come in handy. Highlight exceptions. Detect categories and cluster the data into like groups. In order to perform this, you need to go ahead and connect to that instance of analysis services, and there needs to be a database that you have permission to work with. This add-in will create what we call session models. They're temporary. What will happen is when you, and I'll start the demo on this, when you submit the request like this, let's go ahead and forecast, and automatically it knows to forecast those five series. I'm only interested in the next two steps. The timestamp column is my time index, and the periodicity is monthly. Now, when I click run, what is happening is the add-in is communicating with the server, creating a session mining model, pushing the table data up to the server, thereby allowing it to data mine. It discovers patterns, and then those patterns are queried, and the responses are sent back down for the add-in to represent, in this case, as a chart. Let me show you, first of all, the addition of two rows onto the table. So we could go ahead and fill this in and say, well, that's the first and second month of 2011, and then we have this report that shows us through the dashed line the projected values for the next 2 months. So this has got to be better than just relying entirely on gut instinct. I wouldn't suggest we should blindly take those results, but I would suggest you use both of them. Use your domain knowledge and experience, and then use the results. If they differ greatly, maybe question why, which one would be likely more wrong, yours or its. But otherwise, this could inspire you with more confidence in the gut instinct that you've otherwise been relying on. They're the data mining add-ins. Story with Visio, pretty cool. Visio as a diagramming tool is, interestingly enough, also considered a business intelligence tool in a limited way, but a practical way. You can take diagrams and you can connect them to external data, and then you can relate data into the properties of shapes, and then you can express them through text or colors. So this is ideal in scenarios like this. In this demonstration, I already have pre-built a diagram which represents the servers here at Tailspin Toys. There are in fact five servers, and the selection of one of these, and here on the data tab, go ahead and open up the shape property window. And what you'll see is that shapes do have properties. These are customizable. And you can see here that the server property has already been set to be DC-01. In fact, this one here, which is the file server, has a property of file 02. Now, as part of the self-service solution here, I've gone ahead and created a list in SharePoint. Very, very simple. What is the name of the server? What is the status? Is it online? Is it offline? And as you can see, the five servers at the moment are all online. Returning then Divisio on the client, I can then go ahead and link data to shapes. This is all wizard-driven. You can source data from the Excel workbook. You can source it from a SharePoint list. It can come in from a SQL Server database. Choosing the SharePoint list, I connect to my site and I choose the server list here. And then it adds a data set into the diagram. Now, the data set consists of not just my columns, but all sorts of metadata that aren't so interesting to me. So I come into the column settings and I turn off everything except what I need. There is no select or deselect all, and I would suggest that would be a great idea. Okay, so what we can now see in the external data pane is that I have a data set consisting of five servers, two columns, and let me just reduce this size so the diagram looks more easy. If I drag a row onto a shape, what it does, and you can see with the chain link icon to the left of the row, it's established a relationship between that row and the shape. And interestingly enough, if we then take a look at that shape and look at its properties, we'll see that it's added a new property called status. Automatically, it's enriched the properties collection with those columns and the values in those columns. Now, in order to relate the others, you could manually go ahead and drag and drop each row, or there is this feature here to automatically link. For all the shapes on this page, where the server name matches the server name, go ahead and create those relationships, and you'll see that the other four records are then related. So the next part of this is to go ahead and express this data visually through the diagram. And we can achieve this through data graphics. I'm going to create a new data graphic, and I'm going to add an item into the data graphic that would say, bring in the server name and display it as text. Don't use the default position. I want it to be centered and to be positioned above the shape. There are these styles, and I think heading 3 is reasonably attractive. And as part of the style property, I'm going to increase the font size to 16. And now when I click OK, my data graphic has this item, and then I can click OK to apply it, and it applies it just to the selected shape at this stage. And there you can see the name is up here. Now if I go ahead and edit that data graphic, I'm going to add another item to it that would be to express the status as color by value. Now, the only value that it knows through the data set is the value of online, and for some reason it's defaulting to red. I would suggest red and online is not a good combination. I'm going to make that green, but I will insert another value called offline, and it will be configured as red. And then we can see we have green. So if I lasso all of those shapes, I can go ahead and apply. And now dynamically we have the name and we have the status expressed there. And that's how you can bring diagrams to life, through external data. That's what we can do from a self-service BI perspective using the productivity tools of Office. The next topic is about sharing and collaboration. And as I shared with you this morning, I felt that it was a bad practice to ever attach these diagrams, these workbooks to emails and send them out. From a security perspective, from a version control perspective, this is a nightmare. Let's go and store these documents not on our desktop, but in libraries of SharePoint. What we'll discover then is beyond just the storage of documents, there are amazing capabilities that can be delivered with BI. These are delivered through service applications. There are Excel services and Visio services. Essentially, this is server-side rendering of your workbooks and diagrams and results being sent back through a browser experience. There's also Performance Point Services, which is a performance management application for delivering monitoring and analytics through KPI scorecards and dashboards with reports. SharePoint can be extended with SQL Server add-ins, specifically for Power Pivot and for reporting services. So let's talk about Excel services. Essentially, it is a service that will load a workbook, refresh the workbook connections to get up-to-date data from data sources, recalculate the workbook calculations, and then produce a result that can be then interacted with in the browser. It's pretty much how it works. Workbooks get stored in the SharePoint libraries. The Excel calculation service is responsible for loading, calculating, refreshing external data sources, if there are any. And then the Excel web access delivers the web response. So returning to my Excel workbook then, I have this pivot table and I have a slicer. And I need to share this with my manager so he can learn about, by different year and by region, what's going on. So there's the ability to control what Excel services can deliver. And this is configured through the browser view options. By default, the entire workbook would become available. I could narrow that down to particular sheets, like just sales analysis. You could also parameterize if you have named ranges that are single cells that do not contain a formula. Okay, so it's a single cell named range. What this means is that we can pass values into cells before the calculation takes place. So user input, commonly what you're passing in are filter values from other dashboards into your report to similarly filter those. You can also parameterize the slices that you have within the workbook. So I won't parameterize anything at this stage, but that's where you would do it. And now that I've configured those options, if I go ahead and save this as browse, and I save this to my SharePoint Power Pivot gallery, then that workbook is now in the content library. Users then can navigate across to it, and what you'll see in the gallery, which is a Silverlight experience for previewing the content of an Excel workbook, the bottom right corner shows us the hourglass. It's still computing or preparing the snapshots of the inside. But users can navigate to this gallery and they can preview this. If they like it, they can click it and you'll see, and that was so quick, that's Excel services coming back. And essentially there is the report available through the browser. The interactivity that you have is the ability to work with slices, filters, sort and filter. And also in 2013, the ability to modify the definition of the pivot table itself. Okay, there we see this, all in the browser experience. I don't want to see product anymore on the rows. Go ahead and put region on the rows. Now what's very cool to understand is something I'm just about to talk about, and that's the Power Pivot story, because don't forget that this workbook consists of not just reports, but the actual data source itself, the Power Pivot data model. So when you have the Power Pivot add-in in SharePoint, there are a number of capabilities and features that are then supported in this collaboration platform. First of all, it's just an Excel workbook, nothing different there. However, when Excel Services loads the workbooks and interrogates the workbook connections, it will discover a workbook connection called this workbook data model. And it tells it that there's an embedded data model in there. And then when I do something like this, and this is the first time, and it's very, very quick, but what actually happened there, the first time that it had to re-query the model because I'm filtering by a region, it then detects that this is a Power Pivot data model, and it then takes the data model and restores it to analysis services inside the SharePoint farm. So from a self-service perspective, what was just achieved was deployment simply by publishing a workbook to SharePoint. What that enables the user to do is also to control the currency of the data inside the workbook. So back inside here, you can refresh the data, and that forces a refresh of everything. If I come back to the Power Pivot gallery, I have the ability to also configure data refresh. And if I enable this according to a scheduled frequency, the data can be then kept current. Enable this every day. Go ahead and configure a refresh on just the data coming from the corporate system. Click OK, and then Power Pivot would look after that automatically. Now, for IT departments that might be a little nervous about what's going on here, they can enable logging. First of all, they should be more comfortable in knowing that the document is secured, is being backed up as part of the content of SharePoint, that's all being looked after automatically. The next thing that they're comfortable with is the fact that everything's being logged. Every request for the PowerPivot data is being logged in terms of who, when, and what resources were involved. So therefore, IT can keep an eye on usage, size of workbooks. For example, if they detect that a workbook is growing bigger and bigger every day, then they might want to take action on that. The other thing is, if they see a workbook is being heavily queried by many users, then they've potentially detected a system that's critical to the business or very, very useful for the business and may make the decision that this is not a self-service solution. This started as one, it's been identified as one that has many dependencies, therefore should be taken on board as a corporate solution, and there are paths to take that workbook, import them to create a corporate database, or import them to create a project in Visual Studio whereby they can review, analyze, maybe improve the data model, and then publish it as a full-fledged corporate solution. All right, so this is handoff potentially from self-service into corporate. That's the PowerPivot story. Visio services. So the ability to share that diagram, again, a bad idea to send this to everybody. What I'm going to do is take that diagram and publish it to a library in SharePoint. It's pretty straightforward. There are publish options here. You can control what data sources can be refreshed. There could be multiple pages in your diagram. You can control which pages. Here, there's nothing for me to override. I'll simply go ahead and save this document. And in my SharePoint site, I have a library called Diagrams. So this becomes the server status. And importantly, I must change the save as type to the Visio drawing. It must be the VSDX for Visio services to be able to load it. Okay, what that means is that someone can go ahead and navigate to Diagrams. They can click on the diagram. And voila, server-side rendering of it, which means refreshed data. I'm going to do something a little more interesting. We can assemble dashboards with relative ease in SharePoint by creating web part pages. So I'll create a web part page here that's going to be called server status, and then it's just going to be a full page. So what I love about this is that you are a web developer without any need to write code. What we do is use prepackaged functionality in objects we call web parts, and I can add a web part to the page that comes from the business data category. Note that there's one for Excel web access here. I could embed Excel reports into dashboard pages. For this demonstration, I'll use the Visio web access and add that in. To configure it, I click on the link here to open up the tool pane, and to configure it, what it needs to know is, where does the diagram come from? There's the document that I've just published. And what's cool about this web part is that we can develop unattended dashboards. We can configure the refresh interval from the default of 0 that says don't refresh to 1 minute or above. So every minute it should refresh based on current data. And from an appearance point of view, this just should be called server status. And then I'll make this a height of maybe 800. And as simple as that, I've embedded the diagram into the web part page. I can stop the editing. Let's take a look at this in full screen mode. And beautiful rendering here. Okay, everything's looking good. Let's fix that. So here are our five servers. Because the database server is Oracle, it commonly goes offline. So having said that this is offline, let's be a little patient here, up to a minute, and let's see what happens. Are there any questions in the meantime about any of the material that I've covered this morning? Do you need new CALs for the BI elements? No, you just need the appropriate edition of SharePoint, so enterprise edition if you're talking on-prem. if you have this and users have permission to use SharePoint, they have the right licenses, then they can use the BI features of SharePoint. So the question about SharePoint and Excel services and security. Security down to the data source itself?
Yeah.
Yes, so you've got some options there. You can use integrated security, in which case you'd need Kerberos delegation in place. You can use secure store service to store credentials and have them used. That is, a single account is used by all users. All right. Or you can embed connection passwords into connection strings, and they could be used as well. So there are options for that. One more question in the back. Okay, so the question is about, in my demonstration, when I published the workbook and then I clicked on it in the Power Pivot Gallery, that was in the browser, that was using SharePoint, that was using Excel services. So what that could mean is, let's imagine that I'm the manager doing this and I don't have Excel installed on the desktop, that would be completely fine. In fact, if I had any supported browser, I had connectivity and permission, it's all happening server-side and it's rendered in the browser. I'm not in Excel. Well, I'm in a web application that is the SharePoint application. Okay, so essentially Excel services is delivering an HTML response that's just a web application. You can think of it that way. Think of it this way too. If Excel was not installed on the client, that would not limit us, except that we could not download and make use of that document. Okay, there is the ability, if you wish to, you can go ahead and you could download the document and open it up if you have permission and you have Excel installed on the client. Okay, no more time for questions, sorry, but I will encourage those at the end of the session. Last topic, and I don't have a demonstration for this, but for completeness, because this is a unique offering, for performance management when it comes to monitoring the performance of, for example, sales against quota, then we have a dedicated service application for this. Essentially, it achieves it by a modular design. We can build data sources that connect to our corporate systems, in particular analysis services, data models. We can define key performance indicators that begin together or bring together actuals and targets. The variation of an actual and target produces a status like the profitability. It's either off track, on track, and we define the rules. Indicators allow us to define how to present the status through colors, through icons. And then we assemble a special type of report called a scorecard that shows us the KPIs and their status. We can connect these to data sources to introduce members from hierarchies. Like, there's my sales regions on the rows, there's the quarters of the year on the columns, and there's the KPI at the intersection. Now, that delivers the monitoring capabilities of this product. It answers very well the questions, how are we going according to the expectations that we predefined? Now, where those expectations are not being met, you typically want to know why. And that's where we can introduce reports that deliver the analytics capability of this product. And then collectively, we can assemble a dashboard consisting of filters that bring together these scorecards and reports to deliver highly interactive experiences to understand the hows and whys of your data. And that's Performance Point Services. So in summary, what I've shared with you and I hope I've inspired you with this morning is that Office 2013 and SharePoint 2013 are about empowering business users to produce and manage their entire solutions with a degree of governance and observance from the IT group. Solutions can leverage data preparation, data modeling within Excel and Power Pivot, rich and interactive data visualizations, and even data mining. Microsoft BI, based on SQL Server and Office, delivers comprehensive SSBI features with governance. And this is truly the fruition of Microsoft's long-term vision of BI to the masses. Excel, SharePoint, SQL Server, the trinity that brings us all together. So it looks like you're enthusiastic to create a self-service BI solution. Where do you go next? Well, the great news at this conference is there are some relevant sessions you might want to take a look at. A plug for the Cube Functions this afternoon, my favorite topic when it comes to reporting off data models in Excel. The Power BI topic on Thursday is going to introduce in more detail and cover off where I didn't with Power Map and more detail on Power Query. So there's Power Pivot, Power View, Power Query. Which one did I miss? Power Map. All presented with PowerPoint. How's that? Power Hour on Friday, not to be missed. a humorous take on how these technologies could solve problems in your life. And then finally on Friday at 1:55, PowerView and DAX on OLAP. At level 400, going into much deeper discussion about PowerView when working with multidimensional sources. I'll take this opportunity to thank you for your time and attendance and to stress the need for the evaluations. There are a host of amazing prizes you'll get simply by evaluating this session. It is of great interest for us to understand what you thought. Did it meet your requirements? If so, we'd love to hear it. If not, we'd also love to hear it to improve the experience for other people that attend this event. So I'll thank you for your time and attendance and look forward to your evaluations. Thank you very much.